Well, good afternoon, everyone. Before I turn it over to my colleague, Peter Kaufman, who will introduce our guest today, I'd like to first welcome you all. My name is Maurice Matisse from the Center for New Media Teaching and Learning. I also want to express a special welcome to some of our faculty who are here today, who are part of the RFP winning proposals, who are joining us for the event. And thank you very much for coming. They're sitting up towards the front. One of the things that we know is that the center has been very busy the last couple of years, and you guys are going to make us even more busy in the next few months. While I have everybody's attention, I'd like to make a couple of quick announcements related to online learning and other elements of work that we're in the middle of. The first is related to the Civil War and Reconstruction MOOC, which we launched Monday. And so part two for our Eric Foner course has been launched. It's been a tremendous experience for us. It's our first humanities MOOC that we have done at Columbia. It is also one that we're really learning a lot about how to do these courses. And some quick observations will be released later this week. And those quick observations will include some interesting tidbits. For example, in this MOOC, the last 3 weeks, we actually saw an uptick in engagement from our students. Typically, you hear that MOOCs, everybody just leaves and sheds students. So how do you learn about all these news items? Please sign up with our mailing list. One of my colleagues is in the back. He has an iPad that you can sign up for our mailing list and get a once a month or so digest of some of the releases we've put out. The second thing is I also want to take an opportunity to invite all of you to come to the Rewired program showcase, which is where we end 8 weeks of work by faculty and our staff, and we showcase some of their work, and that happens two times. And we also have little postcards in the back that Alex has if you need the information, but December 5th, Friday in this room, and December 9th up at CUMC, we'll have four faculty doing their showcases here. Back to the Conversations on Online Learning series. We just released the Shigeru Miyagawa's video from a couple of weeks ago. If you click again, new. and so we now have, I think, 10 sessions in our playlist, and the playlist URL is listed up there. Anybody who's interested, you can see we've had quite an interesting group of folks join us, which we started now in 2013 with the provost office, and so we've now have amassed a nice set of sessions. So without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Peter Kaufman, my colleague, who will introduce Professor Robert Darnton.
Thanks, Maurice. It gives me and all of us at the Center for New Media Teaching and Learning the greatest conceivable thrill to welcome our guest from up north today, on behalf of the Center and the Office of the Provost, into the series that we call Conversations in Online Learning. In a piece last month in the New York Times Book Review about his new book, his enthralling new book, Censors at Work, How States Shaped Literature, Alberto Mangel, who is no laggard in this department either, labeled our guest today as the foremost historian of the book and of the art of reading. He is one of the world's great experts on the culture of the Enlightenment, on the nature of memory, imagination, knowledge. One of the world's leading thinkers about digital technology and scholarship and teaching and learning. And because the point of life is not just to interpret the world, but also to change it, one of the world's great activists who can and who has made things happen for our field. Indeed, his vision years ago of a digital public library of America, conceived in the United States, realized in an environment without a ministry of culture or a ministry of the press, without a commissioner for the digital agenda like Nelly Kroes serves for the European Commission in Brussels, nonetheless has resulted in the Digital Public Library of America, which is not a library only online, but in many ways a publishing initiative as bold and experimental as the encyclopedia that he was writing about when his work first reached many of us in this room years ago. Some of his publishers are here with us today. Some of his partners are here with us today. Some of his students are here with us today. Many of his readers and his great fans are here with us today. And now he is here, ladies and gentlemen, Robert Darnton.
Well, thank you for showing up, for inviting me. I thank the provost's office. It's great to join the conversation. It's an important conversation. I'm not going to try to give you a report on research and the 18th century, even though that's where I spend most of my life. But I'd like to talk about the transformation that is occurring under our noses. You know, you're living through it yourselves. So it's something that is actually, I think, revolutionizing the world every bit as much as Gutenberg's invention did, maybe even more. It's easy to say that, and I should begin by saying, actually, there is a lot of loose talk, I'm sure you've heard it, about the death of the book and the obsolescence of libraries. I am convinced that books and libraries are more important now than they ever have been, and they will continue to be important in the future if only we can get that future right. So that's the theme that I would like to develop today. And I'd like to try to develop it by briefly looking backward at the history of libraries and then forward into the digital future, and in particular, to discuss the Digital Public Library of America. Now, the historical importance of libraries may seem obvious. If you take a tour of a typical American university, you will get the point immediately, including Columbia. Here we are at the heart of Columbia University in the library. The library stands at the center of most American campuses, and I think that it occupies a corresponding place at the heart of the university's intellectual life. Libraries pump intellectual energy into every sector of the university, even into laboratories where scientists download material every day in their labs without ever setting foot in the library, yet they get that information through the library. At Harvard, the university actually owes its name to its library. It was a collection of 400 books left to this tiny college by one John Harvard, someone about whom we know practically nothing, except that he had the greatest library in North America. And suddenly, this tiny academy had a wonderful library. 400 books in 1638 was astonishing. And so it changed its name. It became Harvard College. And it grew up around that original core of learning. Today, 375 years and 18 million volumes later, we recognize that the university owes its greatness, above all, from the intellectual riches built up over many generations and stored in the largest library system of any university in the world. But I don't mean to indulge in institutional bragging. That's something of a disease among librarians. You know, how many volumes do you have? Or how many e-books do you have? Instead, I would like to ask a question. Shouldn't Harvard's library and Columbia's library and all the great research libraries of our country be considered as national assets. Shouldn't their intellectual wealth be shared? I'm going to try to make an argument that it should be, but I see some people standing up. There's one or two seats here, a couple there. If you don't be shy, if you want, you won't be comfortable, but I'll try not to go over my time limit. Now, this intellectual wealth, through most of the histories of libraries, of course, was restricted to a privileged few. So you might say that the history of libraries is a story of how privileges have expanded, except that the history of libraries does not follow an upward trajectory without any interruption. In fact, I'll just go over it briefly, there are lots of ups and downs, and we're not so aware of the downside in the history of libraries. For example, from what little we know about the great library of Alexandria, it functioned primarily to store texts, not to make them available to readers. It did admit a few scholars, but its main purpose probably was to glorify the Ptolemaic dynasty. And the same principle applied to the attempt of the Chinese to make a library that would have all the books in the world, that is, all the Chinese books. The Qing emperor, Qianlong, set out to do that by confiscating books from all private libraries, bringing them together in one place, and then burning all of the books that glorified the Qing dynasty or the Ming dynasty, and keeping the ones that glorified his dynasty, the Qing dynasty. So it began with a terrific destruction of books, probably 2,320 that were produced between 1550 and 1750. It was a huge loss, actually, for Chinese culture. And you can find many other examples. In communist Czechoslovakia, there was a general witch hunt through all of the public libraries in the country to confiscate books and destroy everything that didn't fit into the correct categories of the communist regime. They got rid of 7,500 books. And that was very little compared with the 24 million books that were destroyed in the Soviet Union during the Stalinist Great Terror of 1938 to 39. So libraries have been the site of destruction. And we can't congratulate ourselves in some morally superior way in the US because, for example, the great African-American writer Richard Wright was not permitted to borrow books in Memphis, Tennessee, because the color of his skin was black. So he had to pretend that he was a servant fetching books for his white master in order to consult them. So the history of libraries has a dark side. Now, to be sure, the oldest libraries in Europe contributed greatly to culture by keeping books, especially during the Middle Ages. What you are looking at is the way they kept them, that is, behind walls, walls with spikes. I'm going to show you some photos from Oxford University. This is one of the walls. And this photo I will explain in a minute. The point I want to make is that these great collections that went way back to the Middle Ages were fenced off from the general public and limited to the privileged elite who worked inside the walls. The colleges of Oxford have walls that usually are 10 to 15 feet high, and they have spikes on the top of them or shards of glass. In my college, St. John's College, and this is me, the top of these two figures, photographed, I think, in 1962. My college closed its gate, its main gate, at 10 o'clock in the evening. And if you weren't inside those walls, too bad for you, you had to climb over them. Now, there were a few secret passageways, so to speak, to get in. And one of them I'm showing here, that is, you could slip between spikes that revolved and spikes that did not, but it wasn't easy. So the walls were effective. And what I'll do is to show you pictures of spikes and walls that were keeping the books away from the general public. This is the Bodleian Library, the University Library in Oxford, and you see lots of spikes with crenellations in the background. The public looks in, but isn't allowed in. And I could go on, and I will, showing you a few scenes of this sort that I think express very much this old world in which learning is kept for the privileged few. However, what I actually want to discuss are the invisible barriers to the knowledge stored in research libraries. Libraries frequently keep outsiders outside by all sorts of measures, restricted qualifications for entry, payment to obtain a reader's card, and an atmosphere of intimidation. Ordinary folk hesitate to brave these barriers. They're kept at a distance, actually, by a learned elite who wear this air of effortless superiority. It corresponds to what the French sociologist Pierre Bourdieu calls distinction. And so they have been kept out. Now, it's true that, I'll just show you a few more spikes, a few more walls as I go on. It's true that a counter tendency began to gather force in the age of Enlightenment. That's when philosophers like Condorcet understood the diffusion of knowledge to be the most important force, actually, in history, one that would extend everywhere, destroying prejudice and promoting progress. That faith was shared by the founding fathers of the United States, notably Condorcet's friend, Thomas Jefferson, who declared, quote, "The field of knowledge is the common property of mankind," end quote. So as the founders understood it, the health of the republic depended on a well-informed citizenry, and the spread of light, enlightenment, was commensurate with the reading of books. Now, that may sound naive, or in retrospect, it may sound utopian, but it helped inspire the opening up of libraries, and we can trace that process. Ordinary readers were allowed inside the Royal Library in France in 1692. The British Museum opened in 1759. In this country, the first large public library, the Boston Public Library, opened in 1848 and actually allowed readers to take the books home with them. The great New York Public Library opened in 1911, and it allowed in anyone from the street. You didn't have to have a reader's card. And so large numbers of immigrants just walked up those steps past the two lions and could have access to literature in their native languages. But of course, this kind of access to knowledge depended on a very ancient technology, the printing press. Most people in the 18th century could not read, and most of those who were literate could not afford to buy books. But today we have the internet. We now have it in our power to realize what was a utopian vision in the age of Enlightenment. As an example of what can be accomplished, consider the difference between two great encyclopedias. But first, a few more walls and a few more spikes. The Encyclopédie, edited by Diderot and D'Alembert, was the Bible of the Enlightenment, and it was actually a marvel of intellectual production 250 years ago. 17 big folio volumes of text produced by about 200 contributors. It was an astonishing feat, but it cost 980 livres to buy. That is the equivalent of 2.5 years' income for a common laborer. Wikipedia now contains 30 million articles by 77,000 active contributors, as they are called, and it reaches 365 million readers free of charge. So the contrast between these two encyclopedias gives you some sense of how access to knowledge has been transformed thanks to modern technology. But it's more than technology, because we have a new ideal of openness, which is transforming the world of knowledge. Its origins go back to the Enlightenment ideal of a republic of letters, that is to say, a world that in principle would be a free intellectual realm with no police, no boundaries, either of country or of disciplines, that would be open to everyone. But in practice, of course, only a tiny elite participated in the Republic of Letters during the Enlightenment. Today, we have open universities, open source software, open metadata, open access journals, and the beginnings of an open information highway. Unfortunately, however, this tendency also has a darker side. So it's not all this wonderful upward trajectory at all, because in some ways, access to knowledge today is being closed. What, I ask you, is the cost of an average subscription to a chemical journal today? Maybe you don't have the answer on the tip of your lips, so I'll tell you. $4,044 a year for 1 year subscription. What was the cost in 1970? $33 a year. Inflation accounts for only a small part of the increase. During the last 25 years, the price of academic periodicals went up at 4 times the rate of inflation. 1 year subscription to the Journal of Comparative Neurology, I'm sure you all are readers of the Journal of Comparative Neurology, now costs $30,860 for 1 year subscription. With that money, your library could buy 600 monographs. Three giant publishers, Reed Elsevier, Wiley-Blackwell, and Springer, now publish 42% of all academic articles. And these giants make giant profits from them. In 2013, Elsevier turned a 39% profit on an income of 2.1 billion, billion pounds sterling. And that only from its science, technology, and medical journals. Now, don't get me wrong. I am not claiming that the ruinous increase in journal prices can be explained by greed on the part of the publishers. We have some publishers here today. I'm all for publishers. And you could say that Elsevier is doing its job. It's returning the highest possible profit to its shareholders. Maybe it should be congratulated for doing its job so well. But the success of Elsevier and Springer and Wiley-Blackwell should give us pause, I think, because it illustrates the negative counterpart to the trend toward openness that I just was celebrating, namely commercialization, a trend toward closing access to knowledge. The output of articles in medical science doubles every 3 to 4 years. So yes, more knowledge is indeed being produced, but an increasingly small proportion of that knowledge is available to the public. Why? Libraries can no longer afford to pay the prices. The average price for a medical journal was $12 in 1970. It now is $1,470. All over the country, libraries are canceling subscriptions to academic journals because they are caught between decreasing budgets and increasing costs. The logic of the bottom line is, I think, inescapable, but there is a higher logic that also deserves consideration, namely that the public should have access to knowledge created with public funds. Now, I don't know how much you follow this, but there has been a debate that's been going on in this country over the last 10 years, and it's still not resolved. I mean, I won't go into the details, but you might want to discuss it. In February of 2013, President Obama issued one of his famous executive orders, and it required that research funded by taxpayers' money should be made available to taxpayers. Now, what will happen after Obama? We don't know. And it could be that the lobbies in Washington that have prevented the open access to knowledge that has been sponsored by public funds, it could be that that access will be closed. There's a very great danger, so please write your congressman or congresswoman. The battles over journal prices illustrate a conflict between two tendencies that I think will determine the digital future: democratization versus commercialization. How do those tendencies play out in the world of books and libraries? The best example is provided by Google. In 2004, Google set out, as you know, to digitize all the books in the world. And actually, they came to Harvard right away and said, we would like to digitize your books. Lucky you, we'll do it for free. They expected us, of course, to make our books available to Google for free. We thought, this sounds pretty good, because what Google had in mind was a search service. That's what Google was good at. So you, the user, could type in a book title or an author, and then you would get the information about that with snippets if you were doing a word search, that is, a few sentences that were relevant to your search. It was a search service. Sounded great. In fact, sometimes Google would tell you where the nearest library was where you could find the book. So we were enthusiastic. Then Google said, and we'd like to also digitize all of your books covered by copyright. At that point at Harvard, we said no. However, Michigan, Stanford, the University of California said yes. So Google began digitizing enormous numbers of copyrighted books. And it was instantly sued, as you would expect, by the owners of the copyrights. It then spent 3.5 years in secret negotiations with the Authors League and the Association of American Publishers to try to work out something that was later called the settlement. I actually sat in on some of those for various reasons. It's very interesting to watch Google's lawyers go at it. The settlement transformed what was a search service into a commercial library. So Google now proposed to sell subscriptions to this gigantic database and to charge libraries for access to the books which we, the libraries, had provided to Google in the first place, and to charge a subscription price that would be set by Google and that could escalate out of control as the price of journals had done. This did not seem to some of us to be a good idea. The public wasn't consulted. There was no concern for the public interest whatsoever. And fortunately then, the Federal District Court in New York said, Google book search is a violation of the Sherman Antitrust Act. In fact, Google was trying to create a monopoly of a new kind, a monopoly of access to knowledge in digitized form. So that was, I think, quite a turning point. And I think Google would have privatized a vast stretch of the public domain and collected a toll from anyone who tried to enter its fenced-off territory. It was actually an audacious and, in some ways, an exhilarating project. And of course, it raised the prospect of finding a democratic alternative to a commercial speculation. In the era of print, open access as a tradition goes back to the founding of the Boston Public Library in 1848. Over the main entrance to the Boston Public Library is this inscription, "Free to all." Now that we have earned or entered into the digital age, we can make everything free to all, not just books, but all kinds of digitized objects. We can make all of the material in all of our research libraries available to everyone free of charge. That is the basic idea behind the Digital Public Library of America. On October 1st, 2010, we invited a group of heads of foundations, heads of libraries, and computer scientists to a conference, about 40 people, in which we just proposed, in a very schematic way, to create a national library that would be digital and free. Almost instantly, everyone at the conference said, "This is a good idea, we can make it happen." So we decided to create a coalition of foundations that would provide the money, a coalition of libraries who would provide the books, and we began to get organized. We created a steering committee, a secretariat with a small staff, and work groups scattered around the country. We held open meetings, and at these meetings, artists who listened to what suggestions were being made and then would illustrate them by sketches on a whiteboard. So this is an artist at work in one of these public meetings, and this is what some of the sketches looked like. Thousands of people participated. Everything was discussed openly in gigantic meetings that were held in San Francisco, in Chicago, in Washington, D.C. And then there was a great deal of communication through emails and listservs, websites, wikis, and blogs. There was streaming and tweeting and texting, a running debate about every aspect of the plans in which everyone had a chance to be heard. At the same time, there was enough coordination from the Berkman Center at Harvard for the DPLA, Digital Public Library of America, to be launched successfully on April 18th, 2013. Now that the DPLA has celebrated its first anniversary, we can measure some of the progress it's made. It includes 7 million books, 7 million and other objects, three times the amount that it first offered when it went online more than a year ago. And those digitized objects come from more than 1,300 institutions located in all 50 states. They are being widely used. Nearly a million distinct visitors have consulted the DPLA's website. It is, by the way, dp.la, very easy to use. And this is what it looks like. The people who visit and download material from the website come from every country in the world except three: North Korea, Chad, and Western Sahara. I mean, this is developing into a worldwide library. Now, how should you envisage the DPLA? Well, not as a grand edifice under a dome like so many libraries sitting over a gigantic database, but rather as a distributed system. You can browse by place and make a contact with digital databases scattered everywhere. So you go to a map, you click on it, and you can also explore through time. You can take time periods and explore the holdings that are relevant in that way. or you can look at exhibits. I mean, I could go on and on. There are many different ways in which the DPLA makes its holdings available. But the point of a distributed system is that it links up collections that are already digitized in libraries, museums, and archives in such a manner that users can get access to a document with one click on an electronic device. So this is our statement of mission that we improvised at that first meeting on October 1st, 2010, and it still holds. But by now, the DPLA has been incorporated as a nonprofit enterprise. It has headquarters with a small staff in Boston, but it is not a top-down organization. Its horizontality corresponds with its democratic spirit and its basic goal, which is, namely, to make the cultural heritage of America available free of charge to all Americans and, in fact, to everyone in the world. So, far from intending to serve an exclusive audience, such as the elite who have access to university libraries, such as this one, the DPLA is actually designed to meet the needs of many different publics. And I don't think there is such a thing as the American public. There are many publics in this country. And so the DPLA is designed to serve students of all ages, seniors in homes for the elderly, researchers without any institutional affiliation, readers of every kind, including people who just want to deepen their understanding and pleasure in reading. But it's organized in hubs, and I'll just go over the organization very briefly. We have two kinds of hubs: content hubs, which are major libraries, museums, archives that have digitized material and make it available to the DPLA. They include the New York Public Library, the Smithsonian, as well as Harvard and several others. But we also have service hubs. They aggregate other collections and they develop networks at the state level. They make special efforts to reach people in small communities, working with local public libraries. So I'm trying to emphasize the horizontality of all of this. The libraries invite everyone in a town or an urban neighborhood to bring in diaries or letters or family photographs, other items stored in attics or trunks. The material is then digitized, it's supplied with metadata, it's curated and preserved, all through these service hubs, which help librarians do this job. And in this way, it's possible for communities to sharpen their awareness of their own culture and history. And at the same time, their local collections are integrated in a national network which grows organically day by day. Now, this is an enormous enterprise, but we don't have a central organization that's doing it. People volunteer to do it. Because, of course, the DPLA can't reach every community in the United States. So we have now a small army of what we call community reps, that is, volunteers who stimulate activities within designated areas. And thanks to a grant from the Melinda and Bill Gates Foundation, a program is being developed to train librarians in public libraries to acquire the special skills that will be needed to launch digital library projects in their communities. So what does the, this would be an example. You go to Minnesota, you're interested in maybe in the history of farming or in particular communities, you click on certain locations and then it turns out they're linked up with other locations, and soon you are able to cover in rather blanket form a great deal of areas. The technological infrastructure of the DPLA has been designed to encourage these local initiatives and spin-off projects. It, too, was a volunteer effort conducted on a national scale. For 2.5 years, 1,100 computer scientists volunteered their expertise. They submitted ideas. We had a so-called beta sprint in which anyone could send in a proposal about aspects of the infrastructure to be developed. These proposals were judged by a blue ribbon jury. They were incorporated in plans. Those plans were judged and developed and revised and so on. Finally, they were perfected by a team of experts at the Berkman Center at Harvard. And the result is an infrastructure that actually works. I mean, I'm giving you a schematic diagram, but you get the general idea of information being aggregated from all sorts of sources. This infrastructure, when it went live online, functioned. It held up. That's not always the case. If I gather there's some computer scientists here, you know that things crash. We worked hard to make sure that no crash would occur, and it's gone very well. But we've now gone through several iterations in our infrastructure, and it's actually working and serving as a model for the beginnings of other DPLA-like projects in other countries. It was designed to be interoperational with Europeana. And as you may know, Europeana is an organization, its headquarters are in The Hague, which aggregates already aggregated digital collections from the 28 European countries. It's wonderful, but it's clunky, and it has run into a lot of problems. Still, the DPLA and Europeana work together. We're friends. We cooperate all the time. And so this is beginning to look like a world digital library. One of the things that has, somewhat to our surprise, or at least to my surprise, that it's turned out to be important with the DPLA is its API, its application programming interface, which you see as the top yellow bar of those three bars. That makes it possible for people anywhere to develop their own apps and to link them up with the DPLA. So we have had an explosion of apps that are just done by people who want to do them. It's a lot of fun, it seems. One that I especially, here's one or two examples. One that I like in particular is called Bookshelf. So it's a way to do electronic browsing. You know how wonderful it is to go into a great library with books on the shelves, and you pick out the book you want, but then you think, well, maybe I'll sample the book next to it or two books down. And that's how serendipity occurs. Well, now we can do electronic browsing. So these are spines of books. They should really be horizontal to indicate properly what we're trying to communicate. But you can click on the title on the spine of one of these books, open it up to the table of contents. You can search in it, browse through it, and then you can look at books that have been arranged because of their affinity with it. And this electronic bookshelf can stretch out indefinitely, far more than you could get in a printed collection. There are all kinds of apps that involve images, collages. There are lots of things that enhance data about a place like Chicago, in which you can follow up with tremendous precision and get together all kinds of information. So there are outreach projects, and I think that the DPLA is engaging with its readers. It's empowering its readers. It's not showing them what to do. It's enabling them to do things for themselves. It interacts with them, and it enlists them in shaping its own growth. Its potential for education, I think, is enormous, notably in the case of community colleges, which often don't have libraries at all. We can now make available to a community college instantly a fabulous library. Are there problems? Yes, lots, and I won't go over all of them. But of course, having depended on foundations for support, the DPLA needs to develop a long-term business plan. Its technology requires constant maintenance and improvement, and as it increases in size and scope, it must resolve issues of administration and governance. But the biggest problem, believe it or not, is legal. The DPLA must, of course, respect copyright, but copyright now covers, as you know, the life of the author plus 70 years. That means that most books are kept out of the public domain for more than a century. Every book published after 1964 is kept out of the public domain. Most books published after 1923 are not available to readers. Well, are those books being sold today? Do they still have an active commercial life? I think the answer for 99% of them is no, not at all. So we've got to do something to make these books available, but we're stuck with a copyright law. The last version was the famous Mickey Mouse copyright law of 1998. But it's really the 1976 copyright law that is most relevant. It has a famous clause 107 that concerns fair use. Our hope is that the notion of fair use will expand over time. And it is expanding because we've had a series of cases in which courts have declared that a certain activity made without getting the permission of the copyright owner does not infringe copyright. What are those activities? Well, reading for the visually impaired, but also some pedagogical uses. And then there are considerations such as market damage. Suppose a book has not sold a single copy for 50 years. If you make it available, are you damaging its market? I think most judges would say no. And there are other things like the transformational character of producing digital versions of printed books. So a lot is going on in the law, and I hope that we will, in a few years, be dealing with a different world of copyright, but I'm not at all confident. And can we depend on Congress to modify copyright law? I don't think we can depend on Congress for anything. So what we're trying to do in addition to expanding fair use is to get, this will shock you, but here goes, to get authors to turn over the use of their copyrights voluntarily to the DPLA. Now this may seem incredibly naive, but we've created a new organization called the Authors Alliance, and we are asking authors to do exactly that. I think many of you, I'm sure, are authors, that you might be persuaded. Why? Well, what is the average commercial life of a book? What would you say? Yeah, 7 or 10 years, and not 100. So there are, of course, famous writers who make a lot of money from their books, but there are then thousands and thousands of writers, many of them in universities, who make very little money from their books at all. I published a book myself in 1968, and my income from it is enough for me to take my wife out to dinner once every 2 years, if she pays her half. We're not making, most of us aren't making a lot of money from books. We might for a year or two, but once their economic, their commercial life is gone, what do we want? We want to have readers. We don't want the book to sit on a shelf where only a few people will get access to it. So I'm hoping that the Authors Alliance will be a way to mobilize authors to support the DPLA, and it's in their interest. It's not simply asking for charity. So despite the pressure of commercialization, the DPLA has tapped a vein of public spirit that I think is both idealistic and pragmatic. It draws inspiration from the age of the Enlightenment, but it's designed to serve the needs of the 21st century, and to do this at a time of disgust with the dysfunction in Washington, it has proved that it can get things done by independent initiative. You should not think of the DPLA as a digital version of the Library of Congress. It's a new kind of library altogether, not just in its technology, but also in its organization and its spirit. It will operate simultaneously on many levels, the personal, the local, the national, the international, and it is already functioning successfully. It will continue to acquire new functions, I think, with ever-expanding collections for many generations. The technology will, of course, continue to change, and the DPLA will have to change with the technology far into the future. But if we can get things right now, we can help shape that future. For the first time in history, we can make the cultural heritage of humanity available to all humans. We have the technology, we have the know-how, we have the resources, and we have the will. We've taken the first steps, and now we have to get the job done. Thank you.
My question is about copyrights, and I was just wondering if you had any comments about current ongoing threats that would make the currently already onerous copyright statutes even more onerous, such as the Trans-Pacific Trade Agreement, which has currently been secretly negotiated, but leaked documents have shown that there are kind of gargantuan plans to kind of further the tide of commercialization and extend copyrights to even other forms of digital media that that may often or should be in the public domain.
Yeah. Well, I don't know much about the current negotiations over the trade agreement, so I'm sorry I can't inform you about that, but maybe you have some information you could share with us. But behind your question is the worry, I gather, of lobbies and commercialization making deeper inroads in the this new world in which knowledge, instead of being diffused widely, is being fenced off and kept for profit. In a way, that one of the best examples was the, have you followed the Research Works Act controversy? I mean, briefly, the National Institutes of Health, I think it was in 2008, said any research financed by the National Institutes of Health should be made available to the public. After all, it's public money. And the journal publishers just went crazy at that idea. They then insisted that there be embargoes. And it varies from journal to journal, but usually they've succeeded in getting an embargo of 12 months, sometimes 18 months. Not satisfied with that, they then went to Congress with their lobbyists and sponsored something called the Research Works Act. And the Research Works Act would simply abolish the NIH mandate, and they would be back with total control. Well, this raised absolute hell on the part of a lot of computer scientists and people probably like many of you who think that, you know, it's not that information wants to be free, but that the public has a right to information, especially if they paid for the research. So there was a backlash against the Research Works Act, and Elsevier, which had lobbied for it, withdrew, and the two sponsors of it in the Congress withdrew. But then there's something called FASTR, I forget what the acronym means, F-A-S-T-R, which is a proposal for legislation that in all areas, not just medical research, the public should have access to publicly funded research. And the lobbyists are really working hard to prevent it, and it's been bottled up. So Congress comes to an end with the end of by 2016, and we have a new Congress beginning. I think the chances of passing faster are non-existent. So what do we have? We have Obama's executive order. And I think that the people advising, I don't know them personally, but the people advising Obama on technology have persuaded him to do something very progressive. So the Obama executive order, in my reading, is a wonderful step forward, but what will happen post-Obama? So I'm sorry, I don't have more information. But I mean, is there something you'd like to add about these negotiations?
It's called the Trans-Pacific Trade Pact or Agreement. I'm not sure which, but if you search for it online, there's extensive documentation that's been leaked. It's been secretly negotiated with the Obama administration. I think even goes back to the Bush administration and several other sovereign states. And Free Electronic Frontier Foundation, I think it's called, and other open media foundations have posted extensive information online. And it just yesterday I saw a headline that Republicans and Democrats are planning to ratify this in a unusual sign of bipartisanship. So I would encourage everyone to inform yourselves about it, but it does have significant copyright implications for the future of the internet.
Yeah, thank you.
So yeah, it's an exciting set of developments and in the DPLA. My question is, if it was all successful, and let's say you could get all the copyrights and all the books and even all the journals, and everything could be in the DPLA, then what role do you see for the university library in the future? I know there are always some scholars who work in the humanities, particularly with books, they find that more effective. But for scholars who work electronically, what role does the university library have?
Yeah, I mean, it's certainly true that many of us are attached to the codex, the printed codex. We like the feel of paper, we like its smell, we like to thumb backwards and forwards and so on. But I think you're right by saying this will soon be a minority, and most people in the humanities as well as the hard sciences will be dealing with digitized texts. First of all, how much will be digitized? Every great library has special collections of something or other. And those have not, so far, been digitized, with exceptions. So at Columbia, you know, if you've got a great collection on Judaica, my hope is it would be digitized and become available. But it'll be a long time before all of these special collections are available. And I think people will continue to go to libraries to read them, one. Two, students today go to libraries because they can't find their way through cyberspace. Googling isn't enough, and Google's relevance ranking doesn't do the job. So they need help, and librarians now have special training to help researchers get to what they want. So I think this highly specialized training is crucial. Another area is copyright. Copyright is very complicated, and at Harvard we created something called the Office for Scholarly Communications, which handles digital projects in general, but we've recently hired a copyright lawyer who advises everyone in the university who needs advice about copyright, and you need it all the time. If you're making certain materials available in a course you teach, or if you want to put an image on the course or in a book. And our copyright lawyer has trained 15 librarians in the basics of copyright law, so we've got a tiered system. First, a student or a faculty member goes to one of the 15, and if it's a complicated question, it goes to our full-time copyright lawyer in the library, and if it's too much for him, it goes to the university council. So that's a third way in which libraries are performing functions. And a fourth, I'm an historian, and my view is that very few people understand what historians actually do when they do research, because people tend to think we've got history under control pretty much. I mean, it's just stuff that appears between the covers of a book. But if you've actually done research in archives, you understand that the archives go on forever. I work in lots of different archives, but the Archive National in Paris, it's like a New York City block crammed with paper, of which maybe 5%, probably less, has been seen by a human being since it was first written. We are very, very far from being close to digitizing our archival material. At Harvard, we have 35 miles of manuscripts, 35 miles measuring by linear shelf space. It takes about 2,000 pages for, I think it's 6 inches. And 30% of this has not been processed. So, and there's great stuff, believe me, in these 35 miles. So we are digitizing as much of it as we can. I won't go into the details, but it's very exciting because we're trying to digitize everything we have from the 17th and 18th centuries. And we're coming up with discoveries all the time. So, I could go on and on, but I imagine concentration on special collections, use of special services, and also use of the space. Libraries are places of sociability, and if you look at public libraries, well, I won't go into that, but public libraries are nerve centers for communities. In a way, they've replaced churches. And if you want to get a job in New York and you're unemployed, you go to one of the 88 branches of the New York Public Library, because you can't go to a newspaper to read the one ads. You need access to a computer and to a librarian who can show you how to use the computer.
We can move over here. There's a question. If we can ask who has questions to just identify yourselves before the question, that would be great.
Well, I'm a doctoral candidate here, and I have a couple of questions. My first one is a comment. People might look into in this marvelous DPLA and also the copyright problems with what was done by the NIH and the pharmaceutical industry, because the same comments were made probably with less justification, and various schemes were worked out beginning with CRADA in the early 90s, whereby the developers and the manufacturers got their cut, and at the same time the patent problems were worked out. So that would be a suggestion I have that's rather off base. My concern, because I deal with hardcore scholarship in the humanities, is the longevity, in fact, of the databases, because they're now tied to obsolescence in the electronics industry. And you mentioned the funding that you had by Gates. Well, you'll get more funding. The Vatican Library will have continued funding. But what about all these projects of bibliography and all the rest? What thoughts have you on those?
Right. Thanks for the suggestion. And it's interesting to see the parallel histories between patents and copyright. It's a wonderful subject. But I completely agree that the preservation of digital texts is a major, major problem. And no one has solved it. I mean, at Columbia, I know that you are very concerned with it. At Harvard, we have something called the Digital Repository Service. And it's almost, it would seem futuristic if you walked into it. You know, it's like a football field full of all kinds of electronic machines that are buzzing. And they have electric eyes that look at digital texts that are spinning, because they need to pick up where texts dissolve. The ones and zeros come apart in digital texts. And therefore, they are much more fragile than texts that are printed on paper, much more. And so we have this gigantic repository where we store the texts, but we constantly survey them to see if they are beginning to come apart. And then we instantly put a substitute text in the place of the damaged text. And we then migrate the text into different formats, which we preserve in three separate locations In other words, we try very hard, but it's very expensive. And you probably know of Brewster Kahle, and some of you are Brewster Kahle fans. I'm a Brewster Kahle fan. You know, he's this wonderful computer scientist who invented the Wayback Machine to preserve websites. And Brewster says the average lifespan of a website is 3 months. I mean, they come, they go all the time, and they get lost. We've lost most of the material that appeared in websites. And when you think of the losses in general, I mean, more than half of the movies made before World War II have been lost. We have no trace of them whatsoever. So yes, we're facing a major problem. And I've just launched a website of my own that took 15 years to prepare, and I'm terribly worried that it'll disappear like other websites. So yeah, it's a problem.
Take one more question. It's 4:10, and you said you had a question. Yeah.
Thank you so much. I wanted to ask if English is the only language of search and display in DPLA, and could you say a little bit more about internationalization, as you were talking about?
Right. Well, the collections in the DPLA concern, I may get this figure slightly wrong, but more than 350 languages. So the books are in lots of different languages. At Harvard, 60% of our books are not in English. We have, so I could go on and on, but that's, and it's not surprising because most of the scholarship was produced in languages other than English going back hundreds of years. So yes, the collections are in many languages. Also, we are trying, I mean, we're at an early stage. We have a small staff in Boston, but we want to build in a systematic way relations with other countries. So I've just been in Latin America. Everyone I meet there is eager to create a digital public library of Colombia and Peru and Chile and Argentina and Brazil. I'm sure that this will happen in the near future. The key thing will be to cooperate so that mistakes are not made in the way metadata is designed and the way the technological infrastructure is actually built. But that can be done. I mean, we consciously modeled our technology on Europeana so that it would be compatible. And compatibility can be done. It ain't easy because, of course, if you look up the name of a writer in different languages and so on, the name comes out in 100 different ways. So you have to scrub the data, but we found it can be done successfully. So there's nothing nationalistic about the DPLA. We're stuck with the name, Digital Public Library of America. Well, it's too late to change it. You know, I would maybe someday we'll use the World Digital Library or something like that. But I think, you know, get the job done in one place and then see how it spreads.
Okay. I'd like to thank Robert Darnton for taking